I wish to heaven at visiting hours, so I could just show up and bring the news that she's getting older. And I wish that you met her. The things that you learned from me, I got them all from you. Can I just stay a while and we'll put all the world to rights? The little ones will grow and I'll still drink your favorite wine. And soon they're going to close, but I'll see you another day. So much has changed since you've been away. I wish that heaven had visiting hours, so I could just swing by and ask your advice. What would you do in my situation? I haven't a clue how I'd even raise them. What would you do? Cause you always do what's right. And we just talk a while until my worries disappear. I tell you that I'm scared of turning out a failure. You'd say, remember that the answer's in the letter that we create. So much has changed since you've been.
Sometimes it takes place in our life that causes us pain in our heart. But, Lord, we're going to trust you and know that you're with us and that you are working all things out together for our good. And we give you praise and glory and honor for it. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. And so we're going to have a song now.
Sometimes when death has taken a loved one, leaving our lives so lonely and dreary, then do we wonder
Bye.
Dorothy Jane Kidd is ascended to her eternal home Saturday, February 12, 2022. She was born December the 11th, 1938 in Gainesville, Texas, to Lloyd Raymond Boaz and Aura Aline Boaz. Aline. Dorothy was one of the kindest women you would ever know. She raised her five children to be kind, respectful, and always help others in need. She is survived by daughter Brenda Haynes and husband Gordon of Anna, Texas. Daughter Donna Rice and husband Mark of Texas. Son Harvey Kidd and wife Stacy of Perfect, Texas. And daughter Judy Frizzle of Happy, Texas. And five grandchildren, Kevin Martin, Chris Martin, and wife Shante, Megan Rice, and husband Brian, Ashley Hall, and husband Matt, Kimberly Wilson, and husband Cade, and five great-grandchildren. Her sister, Billy Marie Holly, brothers Michael Boaz, Gary Glenn, and Stanley Glenn. Dorothy is preceded in death by her loving husband, Harvey Buck Kidd, parents Lloyd Raymond Boaz and Aura Aline Boaz, stepmother Bertha Jewel Boaz, brothers Lloyd Dale Boaz, Bobby Lee Boaz, Ricky Eugene Boaz, Charles Raymond Boaz, Donald Joe Boaz, and three grandsons. Man, she had a big family. And I know that there's a lot of memories that you guys have. And those memories will stay with you. Lord will comfort you, and He will guide you, and He will counsel you. And you know, I've lost a wife and a daughter in my younger days, and I know that there were things that I did that I wish I had done different. But and some of the times that weren't so good, well, they kind of disappear. And I remember the good things and the good times. And God does that. He has a way of using time to minister those things in our life. And bring healing to us in areas to where we wish we'd have done different. But here's the thing: you can't undo the past. If we did anything that we would have done different then, we might not be able to go back and take care of it in the past. But we can from this day forward work new things and do different things than what we did in the past. And we can remember those who are alive and those whom we love, and we can minister out to them the things that our heart sometimes says, you know, we should do something, but we procrastinate and we fail to do it. But now's the time to speak to your loved ones, to tell them you love them, to tell them how special they are. And today's the day for it to be a brand new day in your life, so that you don't take your loved ones for granted. And but today we celebrate that she's in heaven. And so I want to pray, and then we'll have another song. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for being here with us today. Thank you for the anointing of your Holy Spirit and your presence being amongst us and with us. I give you praise for what you're going to be doing in the hearts and the lives of these family members and friends today. And I honor you, even as you have honored me to be here today, to stand before these people to minister your word of love and life. And I give you praise and glory for it in Jesus' name.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. By and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have flown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly. you by and by, I'll fly away. Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away.
Come to our church a couple times. Of course, I knew Brenda and Gordy and some of you guys, you know, Chloe when she was really little. Some of you I may have met from time to time, I don't know. But I know one thing. God brought me here today because he loves you. And I pray, and I know sometimes you wonder about preachers and stuff, but I pray over every funeral, over every marriage, over every message that I preach behind the pulpit, because God knows the people who's going to be hearing, and he knows what's kind of going on in their life, and so he gives me a word to kind of try to encourage you and minister to you and minister you love and minister life to you. And you know, Dorothy, she's went through life and she's fought a good fight, and you know, I understand that. I believe it was in Happy, Texas, when she actually gave her heart to the Lord when she was a kid. And she went to church, you know, I can't remember the other church, the town, but she, you know, went to church all the time. And I believe that there was Baptist backgrounds and Pentecostal backgrounds. And my wife, she's from Baptist background, and I'm kind of from Pentecostal, so she tells everybody that we're Baptist-costals. And so, you know, I don't know what she was in those regards, but the thing is that when Jesus Christ is living in your heart, you're a child of God and you're a disciple of God. And so that's because we've been resurrected by his spirit into his life. And so, again, as I say, you guys have a lot of memories and that will never, ever fade and they'll always be there. And God's going to be with you. He's going to help you at times when everybody's gone. And you're grieving, the Holy Spirit will be there to help you, to give you peace, to bring you through the grief, and to cause joy to be found. And today, there's joy and dancing and celebrating going on up in heaven. Actually, I guess it took place Saturday. And because the Bible says for a child of God to be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. And so, I want to start off this morning, or this evening, with a compilation of scriptures that I feel the Lord gave me to read for you as though you were hearing from your mom, your granny, or your girlfriend, or I mean, not your girlfriend, excuse me, your friend. And I don't know where that came from. And out of Psalms chapter 23, the Lord God Almighty is my shepherd. He has blessed me with green pastures. He has led me to waters of peace. Yes, he has restored my soul. He has walked with me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Therefore, I have lifted up my soul, O my God, and I trust in thee. The earth is yours, O Lord, and everything that dwells in it. You created the earth and the heavens. Who shall ascend into the heavens of the Lord? Who shall live with you forever in your holy place? Only the one who hath clean hands and a pure heart. And the scripture says, for the pure in heart shall see God. For a person to have a pure heart, they must be born again. They must give their heart to the Lord. And basically, you know, we all understand, most of you guys have, whether you've been in church lately or not, you've heard the stories of how Adam sinned and brought death upon us. And so we were all born in that in that sinful state, in that place of death, right? So we have to be born again or resurrected and from the dead. And so John 3:3, Jesus said, unless a man is born again or is resurrected from the dead, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And this is a resurrection of your spirit from death. It's not the resurrection of your soul that will put on a new body, but it's the resurrection of your spirit. And so there's more than just one resurrection that must take place in our lives than just being born again. And you know, a lot of folks don't understand this the concept of resurrection many times, and they don't understand that there's more than one resurrection. And so the born again resurrection experience is the born again experience that Christians, when we are born again, we fight many battles until the resurrection of our soul takes place. And so the bottom line is that the devil comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy your spirit, so that your soul will never hear the words of God that say unto you when your soul is resurrected. Because here's the thing, if you're a farmer, you've ever been a farmer or a gardener, you've planted seeds, a seed is in one form, right? It's in one body, it goes in the ground, it dies, but when it comes out of the ground, it comes out in a different form. And so in the same way, in the resurrection of our body, when our body is put in the ground, then it comes up out of a different form, because the Bible says that when we as Christians die, and even if we as those who aren't Christians, we're going to put on a new body. And so the devil wants to kill, to steal, and destroy, but Jesus came that he might give us words of life, and also that we would be able to begin to have power in this life as we're walking here with a resurrected spirit or a born again spirit, so that we have the power of God living inside of us, so that when the devil comes to kill, to steal, and to place us in prisons, that we have the power to call upon the name of the Lord and for God to save us. And so the thing is that we are going to in the death that Dorothy has died, she died once. She died to the aspect of being born again, and there were battles that she had to fight. There were evils and different darknesses that she had to overcome, but she fought a good fight. As Paul said in one place, I've fought a good fight of faith. And so here we have Dorothy, and she's fought a good fight, and she's finished her course. And so the thing is as she died in this earth, then she was resurrected, because to be absent from this body is to be present with God, as for a Christian. And so for us to be a Christian and be in the presence of God, then we have been resurrected, and we have put on a new body, a body that is fit to live in heaven in the presence of God. And so that's what our goal is. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to overcome every aspect of this, of the battles of this life, of the darknesses of this life. And we can only overcome them with the help of God. And that is, we can have His help when we are born again or resurrected by His Spirit, and have Him living inside of us, so that every aspect of life that we face, when it comes to kill, to steal, the life of God, the salvation of God, the joy of God, the peace of God, all those things in our life, the things that are out here in darkness, comes to kill those things in our life. And when we have Jesus Christ living in us, His Spirit, then we have power to overcome, so that one day when we actually physically die, we will be able to be resurrected with a brand new body that will be fit for heaven, and that it will live in the presence of God forever. And so, you know, Jesus said in John 11:25, He said, I'm the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me, he shall never die. And so Jesus spoke these words to Mary and Martha and all the Jews one time. And some of you will understand and recall the story in the Bible, because you've heard it preached more often than one, you know, more times than one. But Jesus spoke these words right before he raised their brother Lazarus from death, whom had been dead for 3 days. Now, and Jesus said, Lazarus, come forth. And he rose up from his state of death. Physically, he was resurrected. Now, how many of you understand and know that Lazarus, even at one point, had to die again? Physically, he had to die. And so, even though we see this, Jesus was showing us a picture that there's more than one kind of resurrection. He raised him from his dead state so that he could walk amongst the earth, in the earth. And so God wants to raise you from your state of death so that his spirit will be with you to help you overcome the hurts, the pains, all of the things that maybe you wish you would have done different in Dorothy's life. Maybe the things that you would do different in somebody else's life. Maybe the things that you would do different today or tomorrow. God will give you the strength and the power and the ability to do those things different. But you have to have his spirit living inside of you. And the whole thing is, as many times we think we have, but sometimes we haven't. I was raised in church all my life. And I was baptized in water 3 different times and still didn't know Jesus. Oh, I knew about him. I was acquainted. You know, I knew of him just like I know of certain people in political realms, but I don't know them. And so I knew of Jesus. I'd heard about him all my life, but didn't really know him until one day when I was 21 years old. I come to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And things changed. Everything changed. It didn't mean I didn't have battles, because I do. And the thing is that you will still have battles. Dorothy had battles, but she had the ability to overcome those battles. And there were times that she would have to take medicine, and she would even tell them sometimes, "No, I don't want that red stuff. Don't give me that red stuff out of that cabinet." Because she knew that she had power and strength to overcome those things in Christ Jesus. Now, she might not have said it out loud in those manners, but she knew that she didn't want that red stuff because you know what? See, here's the thing. That is an example for us sometimes when things maybe seem like they might be good for us, but we know that they're not really that great for us, and we don't want them in our life, then we should follow her example and say, "No, I don't want that in my life. I want the blessings of God in my life, and I want to overcome darkness, and I want to overcome evil." And so God will help you do that. See, it's one thing to believe that God will help you do it, but it's not enough just to believe, folks. You have to act upon your belief. And so when you believe that God will help you, when you believe that God will be with you, when you believe that the power of God is working in you and you trust God, then you have to act upon that belief. And that is faith in its total completeness. Without that action, faith is null and void. There is no faith. So Lazarus died, and he had to physically die, and for his soul to be resurrected and to put on his body that would never die. But when I was younger, I used to see billboards up in Dallas, and I used to. Some of y'all might remember the group called Kiss. That had all that white paint on their face, and they were ugly looking and evil looking, and they had these signs that said, we will all live forever. And that used to bug me, but then I got to reading the Word of God, and I realized that everybody is going to live forever. Everybody. Those who love the Lord, those who have the Spirit of God living inside of them, and even those who don't. Because the Bible tells me that in the end, when our soul is resurrected, whether we are Christian or not, that we will receive a body that is either fit for destruction or fit for the presence of God. And so we're all going to live forever. But the thing is we have to ask ourselves, when our soul is resurrected, where do we want to live? Do we want to live in the presence of God, or do we want to be cast into the lake of fire? Because we're going to receive a body that's going to be fit for whatever seed was sown in our ground. Because you see, seed produces seed after its own kind. And if Jesus, the life of God, is living inside of you, that's the Word of God. The Bible says that the seed of God is the Word of God, and that seed produces seed after its own kind. So the life of God will come forth out of you if the seed of God is in you, and you will have reap the harvest of life. Not only as you walk among here, you may have to fight a few battles, but you will still overcome. You will still overpower, because Jesus said, "Behold, I give unto you power over all the power of the enemy, that nothing shall by any means harm you." And so you have to, again, just believing is not enough. You have to act upon that belief, okay? And so there are spiritual bodies and there are earthly bodies. And so anyway, I want you to understand that seed produces seed after its own kind. And you're going to reap. If you don't, listen, folks, if you don't like what you're reaping in your life today, see, you're sowing seed too. And the seed that you sow, you'll reap after that kind of seed that you sow. And if you don't like the harvest that's taking place in your life right now, then you need to change the seed. And you need to start with your seed. Because tomato seed produces tomato vines, and then tomatoes come off of it. And so the bottom line is, God wants you to produce the right seed, okay? The wind's blowing pretty good, and you know, and that's the thing. There's all kinds of winds in our life, and the devil tries to keep us from hearing God. But the devil tried to kill Paul and Peter and John and all of them, tried to put them in prison, right? And as he put them in prison, I'm going to get rid of these notes. As he put them in prison, they were in a dark place. These were people, these were children of God. And sometimes, even we who are trying to do right, we're trying to be what God wants us to be. We find ourselves sometimes in dark prisons. There are things in life sometimes that begin to bind us up, because the devil is trying to kill and to steal the very spirit and the presence of God out of your life, because he knows that there is going to come a resurrection of your soul, and he wants you to be cast into the lake of fire. But God wants you to be cast. He wants you to enter in. He wants you to hear those words, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter in to the joys of the Lord." Now, so Peter, he's in jail. He's in prison. What did he do? He begins to praise and worship God, right? And God sends an angel, and the doors begin to open. The jailhouse doors, on those inner jailhouse doors, open. And he walks out, and he's like, okay, there's the doors are open, and what do I do? Well, and so he feels compelled to walk through those doors, because God opened those doors for him, right? The Bible says God dwells in thick darkness, and here's the thing. When the enemy brings you into dark places, God will go into those dark places to bring you out. Okay? That's what that means. God will go into your dark places to bring you out. And so, Peter, he sees the prison guard over there, not really watching him. And so he kind of walks past one prison guard. And then he sees another prison guard. And he's still kind of worshiping the Lord under his breath and trusting God, believing God. And he says, "I don't know. I got past one guard. Can I get past the other one?" So he walks past the other guard. And then all of a sudden he stops, because the big prison gate is closed and locked. And there's no buzzer to open it. There's no remote control to open it. But God, I was praising and worshiping God, and he's open doors. He's bringing me out of darkness. And so what do? And he began to walk closer to that locked door. And as he got closer to that locked door, the gates began to swing open wide. Folks, I want to tell you, whatever you're going through right now, whatever you're facing, whatever darkness you're in, whatever darkness is up before you, trying to kill you, trying to steal from you, trying to keep you from the presence and the power of God, if you will continue to trust God, begin to praise him, worship him, you say, "I don't know what I'm supposed to do." Well, call on God. God's calling on you. He's calling you today. He sent me here because he loves you. You're special. Whoever you are, every one of you, and each person individually, God is talking to you right now. I know without a shadow of a doubt that God wants to deliver you from some kind of darkness, whether it's a dark influence, a dark relationship, whether it's illegal drugs or thoughts of nobody loves me, nobody cares, that I'll never amount to anything, I'm always going to be this way, I'm always going to be unhappy, I'm always going to be this and that. I want you to understand, Granny or Mama or Aunt or whoever Dorothy is to you, she is saying to you today, listen to what this preacher is saying, because God is here to bring you out of your darkness and restore and resurrect happiness and joy and peace in your heart and in your life. And he's here to change your life today. All you have to do is call upon him and ask him to come into your heart, forgive you of whatever you need to be forgiven. And sometimes we don't even always know exactly what we've done or what kind of darkness is before us. But God, deliver us from the darkness that has us bound, and bring us into the light. Bring us into your marvelous light. Bring us into your blessing. Bring us into the power of your Holy Spirit, so that as we fight battles, that we can overcome them on a daily basis, until the day that we can say that somebody preacher will be able to say, "Hey, he fought a good fight, and it was a good fight of faith,
and her soul or his soul was raised up with a brand new body, a body fit to live in the presence of God, with no hunger, with no sickness, with no disease, with no suffering, no pain of any kind. I'm sorry if I'm preaching, but I'm a preacher. These guys knew who I was before they asked me to come.
Amen.
And I'm here because Jesus loves you. I'm here because Jesus loves Dorothy. I'm here because he wants to change your life today. Let this be a brand new day in your life. All you have to do is, from your heart, say, God, here I am. I hear you calling me. Come into my heart. Come into my life. Come into my life today. You'll never be the same. You'll never be the same again. Father, I pray for each and every one here today, and I pray you bless them and change their hearts and change their life according to your will, according to your
many years ago, in days of childhood, I used to play till evening shadows come. Then winding down an old familiar pathway, I'd hear my mother call at set of sun. Come home, it's supper time. The shadows lengthen fast. Come home, it's supper time. We're going home at last.
Some of the fondest memories of my childhood were woven around supper time, when my mother used to call from the back steps of the old home place, come on home now, son, it's supper time. Aw, gee, but I'd love to hear that again. But you know, for me, time has woven the realization of a truth that's even more thrilling. And that's when the call comes from the portals of glory to come home where it's supper time. When all of God's children shall gather round the table with the Lord himself at the greatest supper time of them all.
Come home, it's supper time. The shadows lengthen fast. Come home, it's supper time. We're going home at last.
Father, I pray one final time here today, and I pray, Father, that there are those who actually came home to you today in a spiritual aspect, Father, of you giving them a brand new life today, changing their lives starting today, Father. And I thank you, Father, that there was a coming home for Dorothy, Father, a celebration in heaven. And God, we don't understand all the things that are in heaven, but one of these days when we get there, God, we're going to be so wonderfully blessed to be in your presence and to be able to see all of our loved ones who have gone on before us, Father. We give you praise, we give you glory, and we give you honor as you watch over each and every one, Father, each and every family member, friend, neighbor, whoever is here today, Father God, that you will watch over them, protect them, and cause your word to minister love, life, and peace and joy. And Father, calls them to rise up in your strength to live a victorious life on a day-to-day basis until the day that they hear you say, well done, thou good and faithful servant, enter into the joys of the Lord. I give you praise for it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
looking back on the memory of the dance we shared beneath the stars above. For a moment, all the world was right. How could I have known that you'd ever say goodbye? And now, glad I didn't know the way it all would end, the way it all would go. Our lives are better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the day. Holding you, I held everything, and for a moment wasn't I the king? But if I'd only known how the king would fall, yeah, who's to say? You know I might have changed it all. And now, glad I didn't know the way it all would end, the way it all would go. Our lives are better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the day. Yes, my life is better left to chance. I could have missed the pain, but I'd have had to miss the dance.
Rich as I could be. my mama made for me. So with patches on my breeches and holes in both my shoes and my coat of many colors, I hurried off to school just to find the others laughing and making fun of me and my coat of many colors my mama made for me. And oh, I couldn't understand it, for I felt I was rich, and I told them all the love my mama sewed in every stitch. And I told them all the story mama told me while she sewed, and how my coat of many colors was worth more than all their clothes. But they didn't understand it, and I tried to make them see that one is only poor, only if they choose to be. Now I know we had no money, but I was rich as I could be in my coat of many colors my mama made for me. Made just for me.
I could see